Hello, everybody, and welcome to a special broadcast of Wake Up Adapt here on WACN Radio for all of our ANCOR viewers and listeners. I am your Adapt Community Network Director of Recreation, but of course, your hostess with the mostest, Alicia Angevine, and I am joined by our special guests, Jeisson Cardona, Peter Cobb, and Kelly Spina. Hi, everybody. Can you quickly introduce yourself to the ANCOR viewers and listeners?
Hi, my name is Jeisson Cardona. I'm a coordinator of operations with Adapt Community Network, Adult Day Services. I've been with Adapt for 15 years, and today we're going to talk about WACN and our virtual programming and the impact that it's had on the people that we support.
Hi, I'm Peter Cobb. I'm the Director of Community Outreach with Adapt Community Network. I've been here 13 years, and I'll be talking about a variety of different innovative services and supports that we've set up in the virtual age, including our calendar network, Trumba, that enables everyone to join all of our programming with a single click.
Hi, ANCOR audience. My name is Kelly Spina. I'm also a coordinator of operations and adult day program. I'm going to be walking you through some of the impact this technology has had, what our devices and distribution process has been like, and also future application.
All right, thank you guys. Well, for all of our first time viewers and listeners, first things first, what have you been waiting for? However, if you are unaware or you didn't know, on a daily basis, Wake Up Adapt is the virtual morning show that provides fun and educational topics to our Adapt Community Network audience. During a usual airing of Wake Up Adapt, here is where we will introduce our five fun facts related to the national holiday of the day. But in today's special airing, we will spruce things up a bit. Let's insert some informational pieces here from our special guests. First speaker up, Mr. Jeisson Cardona.
March of 2020, like the rest of the country, we were completely caught off guard and by surprise to many. By the COVID-19 pandemic, our program suddenly had to shut down. And living in New York City, it was a harrowing and really scary time because suddenly we became the epicenter of this unknown crisis. And we were seeing things in New York City that for many of us prior to that, we were witnessing just simply on the news in faraway lands and Italy and in China, and something that we never thought would be possible where we were living. And, you know, it's our program shut down, and there was really no time to truly prepare for what we were going to be facing. We spent a good portion of the time over the next month just ensuring safety and making sure that people were okay and had enough food or support that they maybe needed during that time. And, you know, many of us hoped and thought that maybe this would just be a 2-week blip or a month at tops, and, you know, we would be able to just go back to our normal day to day. And as time went on, we really began to realize that this was going to be something that we were going to have to deal with for a much longer period of time. And we wanted to bring back some sense of normalcy to the people that we support and our staff who were just looking for some semblance of hope or normalcy for them. And we had this idea of bringing to life a morning show that was originated in one of our programs in Staten Island to provide an hour of daily enjoyment for the people supported that they could engage in and participate in. What the goal was to create something that was visually appealing, but also could be something that if somebody didn't have the technology, they can just call in as if they were just listening to a radio station. And WACN was born. It's a Wake Up Adapt Community Network. And we thought that it would be great to have a routine every morning for the people supported to look forward to that wasn't going to be the doom and gloom of the news and the things that they were seeing anyway, but maybe a change of pace for what their day-to-day was. And we developed the show, and the show has, from May 4th, 2020 was our first episode. And from that point, it slowly grew and grew in our numbers and the participation that we got from many of the participants within all of our boroughs and our programs and our partners. And that slowly ballooned into more virtual programming and channels. We started WACN. We had only two networks, and now we currently have nine, and with multiple entities that are doing various things. And the impact during the pandemic and the beginning stages of our wake-up show were felt right away. And it's been a lasting impact, and it's something that we've actually produced an episode every day of Wake Up Adapt and our WACN programming from the onset of May 4th. And every day without fail, we've been able to produce something that people had to look forward to. And suddenly our virtual programming platform and ideas were coming to life. And all of the things that we started were not with anything that we didn't have before. All of the talent and all of the things that we were doing are honestly things that we were doing in our program sites, but we just learned and figured out how to replicate that or mimic it in a virtual world. And for a lot of our people, WACN provided a sense of hope during a really dark period of time. And to this day, it's something that people wake up to every morning. They go through the process, and they understand the rundown and the lineup. And, you know, we do our best to bring something different and new all the time. And as you're going to see in some of the footage that you're about to see, you know, we're going to hear some of the people supported and our staff talk about the impact that WACN, Wake Up Adapt, and our virtual programming has had for them, and the importance of it during this pandemic. A lot of the things that we've been able to create and do are things that anyone can really do, utilizing the talents and the skills you already have in place. It's just about maybe changing and repositioning what some of those people may be doing. And to be honest, oftentimes what we've noticed and discovered during this process is that there are a lot of people with a lot of talent that is just waiting for a chance to shine and show out. So please enjoy this clip. Thank you.
I was saying, is there anything you'd like to share or say to someone, right? If someone doesn't know what WACN is or any of our virtual programming, like, what would you say to them to describe what it is or what it means to you?
WACN is, I would say, a learning platform, because you learn something new every day. And that the virtual groups and classes we have are very beneficial.
Okay, awesome. Thank I agree. And what about you, Joel? If you had to tell somebody what WACN in our virtual classes and all of the stuff we do, what would you say to them?
I would like to have a fun. I have to get to the experience and learn. And I will learn. I could learn the skill. I would like to learn the skills over my class.
Okay. What about you? What would you say to someone who didn't know or wanted to share about what WACN and all of these things are?
What WACN for me is a great platform. It's fun to interact, you know, with your staff and with your friends who you don't really see, you know, but virtual. What I got out of the WACN is honestly confidence, because for me, doing the overview, that's a great platform, you know, because I want to eventually get into the communications field. So for me, I feel me doing the overview is a great thing for me and for everyone else, because it gives you a chance to learn different things and also accomplish your goal. That's just my personal view.
Thank you. What about you, Alia?
Mm-hmm. best thing that happened in 2020 because I learned a lot new people. I did a new thing. Co-host city, and I have my own program. Yeah.
Okay. The best thing that happened in 2020.
2020.
Mm-hmm. Because you got to learn a lot of new things with people. And on top of that, you have your own program now. Right. So, Timothy, what would you say for someone who didn't know what WNCN and some of our virtual platforms are? What would you want to say?
Okay. Well, one of the things I would do for a certain is to encourage people to see the intelligence and the talent that exists in this environment of our profession, you know, because the fact is, and to be honest, you know, there's a certain stigma in people's minds about our environment, and I think that would really help to clear up some misinformation that people have, and have them look at people as people in a very different light. That's what I would say.
Thank you. Laquavia?
I would definitely say that it allows, like Chinique was said, I would definitely piggyback off of that. It gives everyone that confidence because they are home and they're learning to communicate better. So when we all get together, we'll be talking to people that they might have never spoken to before in program. It does display all types of talents where we find out more about the people that we work with. Like, Ali, I never knew they called you trouble until I started coming up. You are big trouble. But it definitely gives everyone that we work with the reassurance that we're still here for them, even though we are all social distancing. It just gives them that extra kick to keep them active, just so that they know we're still here for them. Though we're home, but socially, we can always connect through the internet, and that's great. It just gives them that extra push that they need that they may not be getting from home. So it's a beautiful thing. I truly enjoy it.
Awesome. Alicia.
All right. Well, you guys touched upon almost everything that I would have said. And for me, WACN is a DAP community network new norm. I don't know what the pandemic is going to continue to bring to us in these days and months and even years moving forward. But what I do know is that a DAP community network cannot be stopped. This is our multifaceted virtual program where we share our social abilities, our mental abilities. You know, we just have fun with one another. We get to see each other on a regular basis when in a time where we don't know when was the next time we would be able to see each other as close as this. You know, virtual programming, I know, is not something easy to do because things are not tangible, but we make the best of it. And I think that WACN provided the most greatest platform for us just to discover new talents, to be creative, you know, to dig deep and do a little bit of soul searching, because a lot of people were out and down during the pandemic. And I'm just glad to know that we were resilient enough to jump into this, get onto our platform. And not only do you guys support it, but you guys love it and it's working. And, you know, we have a following, and it's not just, you know, it hasn't been wavering since we started. And I appreciate that. And to me, it's a new norm. I know that I'm going to wake up each and every morning and see some bright, smiling faces in a time where things are still going on outside. You know, we have to be realistic to that. Things are still happening outside. Quarantine and COVID and all types of depressing things are still happening outside. But this space that we share is no frowning faces. It's no sad faces. This is just it's the most beautiful platform. And this platform lasts for hours. So could you imagine while the world out there is going a little crazy, we're together being sane and being happy and fun and loving. And I love that. So.
Okay. Joel, you got something for us, my man?
Yeah, to share with everybody with a great expression that will give that I'll share with everybody why I have the information about the weather report. I share with everybody while using my own phones on doing the weather report. That will give out a good feeling. They could help me learn a lot of better from the weather report. And they're gonna give me a confidence while that I learn from the experience, and I could moving forward. They have to keep. I would like to keep everybody occupied.
Thank you, Joel.
That will never happen. We always learn. We was learning, getting experience. Like I would be creative. Like. Do the amazing moves with everybody, and I would enjoy. I even listen to the music of the day, which makes me more relaxing about this.
I think that, Joel, to piggyback off of you, Alicia talked about, you know, people were down and out. I can tell you I was one of those people.
Yeah.
And honestly, more than anything, provided a sense of hope for me to know that I had a regular routine in the morning every day. And the routine was really important for me. And I'm just speaking selfishly in that instance of, It was so important to me so that I had something to do that gave me purpose. And, you know, watching and seeing everybody grow through it has been more rewarding than anything that I've done in the 15 years that I've been doing this. And so, you know, for that, I thank you all and being a part of that change. I've also had the privilege of seeing Adapt Community Network really show the family that it is. When you see people from Staten Island, from Brooklyn, Manhattan, and the Bronx, all of which are represented in this call right now, actually. And people who are DFPs, directors, unknown operations staff, and you know, with Shaniqua and Vernita, you have executive staff that are working with you to produce a show, it shows that we're all together in this. And so I want to thank you.
And Jeisson, you want to listen to, like me, for me personally, you know how, cause you know you watch the news so much to where it makes you feel like you're depressed for no reason? That's how I was feeling. I got hooked on WACN. I can't let it go. So now, for real, like every time I'm always on WACN. So me personally, I stopped watching TV and I'm just hooked.
That's right. That's awesome.
Thank you so much, Jeisson, for all that great information regarding WACN and our virtual programming. All right, now let's turn things over to Mr. Peter Cobb. Hey, Peter, what's this Trumba thing all about?
Thanks, Alicia. I'm going to actually start with this a little bit before March of 2020. In January of last year, we had just come off a very successful performance of an adaptation of Alice in Wonderland, which was rehearsed and performed at the Gibney Theater in Manhattan. The cast included actors not only supported by ADAPT, but professional actors who had volunteered to be part of the project. The two final performances were sold out and really brought us together as a community.
She made some tarts, all on a summer day. Then the white queen took the cake. Then the white king took those tarts and took them far away.
Consider your verdict.
I think he's guilty.
I think he's innocent.
Me too, me too.
Wait, wait, there's a great deal that comes for that.
Based on that, in February and early March, we had held auditions for the next performance that we were producing on Metamorphosis. This was always designed to be an in-person project, much like Alice in Wonderland, but then March 2020 happened, and we all know what that looked like. A few weeks later, when it became clear that we were not going to be reopening our doors right away, our theater team decided to get the rehearsals started and started having weekly rehearsals on Zoom. The idea at that point was still that this would be an in-person performance and that this would just limit the amount of time it took to get everybody back up to speed. What resulted was a whole series of rehearsals, full cast and scene-by-scene rehearsals that culminated in a virtual performance of On Metamorphosis.
Wash your hands under the foaming white water.
Will my daughter be restored then?
No, you'll only lose your gift. She and everything you have touched will remain golden, as a reminder of your foolish greed.
My only daughter? She needs to come back.
It was your choice that led you to this fate.
I cannot go on.
Feeling the weight of his grief, King Midas washed away his gift and abandoned his kingdom to live out his days in the forest with nothing but the clothes on his back. The birds wept for him, and the throngs of beasts, the flinty rocks, all mourned. The trees, it seemed, shook down their leaves, all to King Midas. There was a boy, a very enchanted boy. His beauty rivaled the gods, so he was given the name Narcissus. With this beauty also came pride, so fierce, no boy, no girl could touch him, even though they longed to.
Hey, Narcissus, go on a date with me?
No.
I heard you like me. I really like you too.
Oh yeah, oh you, oh you, do you.
You're looking good, Narcissus.
He was out hunting one day, when a nymph named Echo saw him and followed him in secret. She was a nymph whose way of talking was peculiar.
Thank you so much for being here. Hey, we have the cast back together. Thank everyone for watching. We're so happy you could make it. And thank you, amazing cast. What a beautiful, incredible show. Woo!
Woo! We did it!
We did a good job.
We did it!
Yes!
We did it!
Amazing! Sorry.
No, I didn't. But what I will say is, maybe this wasn't surprising about the show, but what was really surprising to me about this whole experience was how everyone sort of came and gelled together, even though we weren't really working in the room with each other and we didn't get to see each other a whole lot. We still made connections and made friendships and had a lot of fun from our houses. And mm-hmm. I think sometimes we forget that that's the point of making art. And so I was just really grateful for this whole process because it got me through part of some of those really difficult times during these past couple of months where we're all really alone. And I hope theater isn't always like this, but I'm so glad that the theater still happened.
Anyone else on how maybe you transformed or changed by being in this production?
Well, me, it changed me a lot because it opened who I really am. It opened me up more, and it opened me up from my shyness.
That performance was also very successful, with hundreds of people joining in on Zoom to watch, and again brought it up together as a community. Following that, now in our virtual world, our playwriting group wrote and applied for and submitted a play to an international playwriting festival put on by the Center for Applied Drama and Autism in Ohio. Our play was selected and will be performed this summer in that festival, which also includes plays from Ohio, but also international plays from India and other countries. So all of this basically just showed us that there were a lot of opportunities and a lot that were available to us. Shortly after that, we started having a variety of classes that were available online: fitness, education, theater, basically everything that we were doing beforehand, we were doing now, but we were doing virtually. Whereas in real time, we would go to the MoMA, we would go to the Whitney Museum, we would go to other places. We're now conducting virtual museum tours in Paris, or we had our art lovers visited the Louvre, and it was very popular. One of the things that we found out that was a challenge for a lot of the people that we worked with and their family members who were helping them navigate the technology was we were relying on sending text messages, emails, links to the people that we support so that they could find the way to join all of this. And to be quite honest, a lot of them were having difficulties with that. We had to meet the people where they were. So some activities were on our in-house system life size, but other people were using Zoom, they were using Skype, they were using WhatsApp. We were using whatever the people that we work with had and knew how to use. What we always wanted was to set up a system, much like university, where you're not limited by what school you're in or which program you attend in our case, but you could join anything throughout the agency. For that reason, we explored and decided to use a calendar system called Trumba. Trumba allows for a one-click browsing and opportunity to join any activity throughout the agency that's virtual. One of our participants here will walk you through it a little bit.
I recommend that all participants and staff delegate their activities with their individuals and go on Trumba.com to choose their classes. And the way you do it is that you use instructor description and you click on it and go down and see Alia Amathio's class. And I chose the Express Yourself, but you can choose any class that you decide that you want to participate in. Trumba is really easy for me. It helps me navigate my classes that I want to decide to go on. And one of my classes that I actually choose to participate in is my friend Alia Amathio's Express Yourself class.
As you can see, we have a wide variety of offerings, and the Trumba calendar system enables anyone to join at any time, simply with a click of the mouse. What it's really enabled people to do is follow their favorite activities throughout the agency, no matter where they're being held. If someone's an art lover, as an example, they can go to Trumba, they can look at all of the art offerings that we have and help plan their schedule accordingly, as opposed to being limited to join just whatever is happening in their, you know, given program channel. One other thing that happened that I'd like to highlight is over the years, one of our most popular activities in the nicer weather months has been Art in the Park. Instead of doing art in classrooms, we go out to the various parks in New York City and beyond and enable our art lovers to get out into nature and be inspired to create their artwork in what New York has as nature. Last summer, when it became more and more clear that outdoor activities were looked at as more safe, we decided to resume the Art in the Park. And one of our art specialists, Natalie Reichel, came up with an idea called Hidden Gems. Hidden Gems was actually based on Metamorphosis because she was helping our artists create artwork that was used in the performance of On Metamorphosis. Natalie's idea was that she would have a morning session and an afternoon session. She would paint rocks, hide the rocks around the park, And when people found them on an in-person scavenger hunt, what would happen is she would stop and give a lesson on the motivation and the art history beyond the artwork that was on that art. Because everyone wasn't comfortable yet going in person, basically it turned out that we had very good attendance in the morning sessions, but in the afternoon sessions, not as many people were showing up. The way that we adapted that activity was we live streamed the activity on Zoom, and people from the programs were able to join it. And in the afternoon session, Natalie basically became a video game character that the people in the who were viewing the activity were guiding throughout the park and having her find the rocks for them. This became very, very popular. People loved it. And I think it's a model for some of the different hybrid activities that we've done and that we're looking forward to do in the future. Thanks, and now we'll transition this over to Kelly.
Thank you, Peter. That was so informative. Now let's finally hear from Kelly Spina, who can tell us some next steps and what the future will look like. Kelly?
Hi, ANCOR audience. Are you guys still with us? My name is Kelly Spina. I'm a coordinator of operations for adult day programs with ADAPT. And you can see from my colleague's presentation thus far that technology has played a huge part in us being able to achieve what we have so far. And I'm going to bring you through some of that impact. What we saw after making the initial investment is that technology use was actually soaring. So ADAPT was dedicated to distributing hundreds of iPads and Chromebooks in recent months to the people who didn't have access to them previously. Originally on our platforms, what we were finding is there was about a 30% usage of video participation in the beginning when we had launched after that first month. But predominantly people were using phones to access our platform. And that's what people had available to them at the time. After our initial investment, what we were finding about in October is that that had soared to almost 90% of people using video features. So in about a 5 month time, that number was increased incrementally because people were seeing each other's faces. And that was the investment to learn. That was what got them over the fear of technology and the hump, because it meant that they could connect with people that they cared about. I say this to say that it ended up being a worthy investment for us. And as some of you guys go back to your own agencies, you know, I encourage you to look at different programs and opportunities that might fiscally allow you to do the same. Our agency did look into a lot of grants and stipends. Based on geography, you might have different programs that are available to you. Also, what we're finding is that with the education push, a lot of people who are graduating out at 21 will now have access to technology as they enter into our program. And at least the foundation of understanding how to use that technology. So this new virtual world, right? I mean, there was definitely a tech tidal wave happening. And we wanted to ride that wave in an attempt to stay current and be able to provide people with real life skills. I think we were all kind of witnessing firsthand Zoom takeover, people joining with Lifesize and WebEx and Microsoft Teams. So globally, people were transitioning online. Institutions, organizations began offering free web classes, free opportunities like the New York City Ballet was holding classes. You have cooking recipes and audiobooks and all of these different things that were being released to the public. There's still a lot to take advantage of, and we don't see that decreasing. So from tech literacy to opportunities, right? All of this investing and all of this jumping in the tidal wave created some pretty impactful things. So first was the foundation of tech literacy for people, the understanding that we log into something and it allows us to see people. We have to toggle and use these different keys and mouse and numbers to be able to get the device to complete the action that we're looking for. And ADAPT is invested to having all of the people that we support in the program now receive email addresses, because we do believe that that is an important foundation as they move forward in life, to be able to correspond with others and to access other opportunities. So with all of that tech literacy, even things that we were learning, right? The muting, raising our hands, all this etiquette that kind of came in with it. it's actually opens a tremendous amount of doors and opportunities that I don't know anybody could have been privy to prior. The first thing that is really important for us to note is the opportunity for volunteer or internships or even employment. So at this time, everybody is transitioning and being flexible with working from home. And what that does for our population is it actually removes a lot of barriers that may have previously been there. So for example, lack of access to facilities that could accommodate their sensory needs or their wheelchair needs or their restroom needs or their social anxieties. All of that might be mitigated if that person is able to work more conducively from home, now understanding all of these login, toggling, and different effects. It also provides a person more independence in their downtime, understanding that these are things that they're able to access on their own and join outside of day program hours and independent of when they're here with staff or not. And that's even leaked into people being able to make better connections to the ones that they love. They're able to video chat with their friends and family. Some of them can't stop videoing their friends and family now knowing that that's available to them. And we love that it creates more of a routine and a schedule that best fits that person's needs. And the last piece, which has really been great, is as it relates to technology and adaptive purposes. A person that now has a foundational understanding of how an iPad works can then take that next step to hook up their lights to that iPad, to be able to control an Alexa that is able to mitigate some of the obstacles they might have had in their home previously or bedroom, and allows for a little bit more of an independence method as well. So I say this to say that all of this is such an amazing tidal wave that we couldn't have anticipated happening. We see technology only becoming more integrated for our lives and the people that we support. And that literacy will really transcend as the evolution of technology becomes more integrated into the fabric of our society and our day-to-day. We're giving people an opportunity to get that foundational understanding and really develop from there. We see the opportunities as limitless, and we're really excited about what the future has. If you have any questions about anything that's been gone over in this presentation, we encourage everybody to send an email to some of the presenters here today. You'll find our email addresses attached below, and we'd love to network and find out more about what you guys think.
Thank you guys so much for all of your time and patience here at ANCOR. There was a lot of information shared, and I hope that you took away some vital notes. We here at Wake Up Adapt would like to wish you all a safe and healthy rest of your day. You guys have been such a quiet audience. However, if you have any further questions, comments, or concerns, feel free to share them now. If not, on our daily basis, this is how we end our show. We want you to know that this is Adapt Community Network. We change, we adapt, and we survive. Later, guys.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you guys so much.
Good.
What's happening?
He's recording.
I'm recording. Go ahead.
She wanted to make sure we had enough bloopers.
That's fine. Go ahead. Continue. Oh, this is keep going. I'm still going.
Kelly, that was amazing information. Thank you.
Isn't it Peter's information?
Thank you, Kelly. I was so confused.